Guys, Zack Mars here, and this is my review of Gravity Falls. Off day 14 of Gravity Falls month, we have Gideon Rises, the second half of the season finale. So this episode is fun as first and foremost. It's probably sets up the highest the stakes have ever been, being that, you know, the show itself is at risk of ending early because, you know, the entirety of, you know, it's the second season, it's the first, there's the second season I don't think had been approved yet, I don't think, but they were like, we got one season. We're going to end the first season on a big hype moment, and people are definitely going to be interested in the second season, I think, after this. So, it's a very good reason they, and it's a very good thing they got the second season, but because that would have been a really mean cliffhanger for them to end on if it just ended. But, especially nowadays, since Disney has developed a kind of a habit of canceling their shows early, unfortunately, a lot of programs, things have happened where, you know, mostly because of streaming, I'll be openly admit that it's mostly because of streaming and everything being out in one go. You can't actually build an audience like that, so they all die after, like, a lot of them die after, like, one season unless they're really popular. So, unfortunately, it's something that happens a lot more nowadays, but not so much back then, back when, you know, streaming was kind of in its infancy and wasn't as widespread yet. But, I'm realizing this is supposed to be a review of Gideon Rises. Okay, so Gideon Rises! This is an episode, again, this is an episode where you know the entirety of the show itself is at risk. And, it's essentially this idea that Gideon is now trying to become all-powerful now that he's won. So, it's a really and there's a really fun dynamic here where Gideon has a lot of knowledge that we don't know. And that is made very apparent in this, you know, in this episode as we kind of see like how the first season actually shakes out at the end. There is some interesting information here, which is fun, and I do like it, but also some interesting things that the episode brings up that aren't entirely true, we'll get to them, as well as, but it's overall a really satisfying ending to season one, and I love it a lot. But, yeah, in any case, the episode kind of opens up with Dipper, her scene kind of playing off the idea from last episode of, you know, dreams, nightmares, and those kind of things. The episode opens up with Dipper having a nightmare of a shadow descending on the town as the Mystery Shack is destroyed. He then wakes up, has a nightmare, and tells everybody about it, and it's then revealed that in actuality, it is not so much a nightmare as it is his reality. That Gideon did in fact steal the shack, and the Pines were first to move in with Soos and his grandmother, who we meet for the first time. She's fun. But, and also voiced by a man, which is really funny. I forget who specifically voices her, but it's just really funny that, you know, like, I want to say, I really don't remember. I will put it an editing note, because I can do those now, because my editing notes just randomly work again. My titles just work in my editing software again. I don't know what happened, they just randomly came back. But, figured I would explain that as I was making productions. I started editing the first episode as I'm recording this, and I'm like, My titles are just back. What the hell is this? But, yeah. Like, but in case, yeah, Soos of course has to move as to, Soos of course offered to bring, but let the Pines move in with himself and his grandmother, which is very nice. But, overall, Mabel of course just likes the idea of meeting Soos's grandma, pointing out that her old person's flesh is very wrinkly and soft. And of course, Stan tells Mabel to quit being creepy, and immediately turns on and tells, and especially since he points out the news is on, at which point, we do find out this whole, what Gideon's ultimate plans are. Like, or at least, like, we do find out that, according to the news, and Chandra Jimenez on the news, we find out that Gideon has a big plan it's revealed, like, obviously the town now knows that Gideon has taken surprise ownership of the Mystery Shack and has a big plan for it. Like, he openly explains that he's going to be holding a press conference and that the entire town is invited and that it's free admission if they remember to wear their Gideon pins, which are these, you know, these little pins with Gideon's face on them. Like, pretty self-explanatory. But, we also find out that, you know, they kind of refer him as local shyster Stan as local shyster Stan Plines, and it cuts to him in a devil costume, which, of course, Stan is taken out of context. But, meanwhile, watching the news, Dipper can't help but feel dejected because he's supposed to save the day and is supposed to be the hero, and unfortunately he failed and Gideon got the shack back. But, Mabel, of course, insists that, you know, even though her brother failed, she's not going to, and declared that now it's her time to shine because she has her grappling hook. Which, of course, Dipper then immediately points out has literally never helped them once. And in truth, it wasn't. It just showed up in the first episode, has never been mentioned throughout the entirety of the series up until this point, and doesn't get any sort of use prior to this. But, yeah, of course, Mabel points out that's nonsense, and that she'll be more than happy to save. She'll be able to save the day with it. At which point, she breaks a massive jar of jam that splatters all over the walls, and Soos's grandma has to clean it up, or Abuelita, as she's referred to. But and of course, Soos points out that, you know, he's not particularly all that upset about the idea of them leaving, pointing out that on the one hand, if they get the shack back, great, but on the other hand, they can always bunk with him and his grandmother, and also reveals that he has a slot car track, which and then he also vomits up something from his, and coughs it up and decides that, would it be a new law if I eat this? I'm gonna eat it. And which causes Stan to realize they do, in fact, need to get the shack back. In any case, it is at this point where, you know, Gideon is in fact having his press conference, and kind of realizing they need to figure out a way to get the shack back, Stan proceeds to have everybody sneak in disguise so they can infiltrate the press conference at the Mystery Shack. And we do find out there's a banner that says Mystery Shack Grand Closing, which, you know, is a funny little detail. Because, you know, Gideon doesn't particularly care for the Mystery Shack, so it makes sense he would just close it outright. But it is at this point where Gideon then proceeds to get up on, like, Soos's disguise is not particularly great. He's wearing a very obvious fake beard and has a sign that says not Soos on his hat. So he's very obviously Soos, but also not. But, of course, everyone having successfully snuck in on disguise, we do find out Gideon does, in fact, an organ piece from his father. He comes on stage in a very flashy way, because it's Gideon, and proceeds to get up and start addressing the crowd. And we do find out that that everybody very much has high admiration of Gideon, because he's able to predict a lot of different things that going on with their life. Clancy Susan mentions that, a couple of examples that are given. Lazy Susan mentions that he figured out the secret ingredient to his coffee omelet, to her coffee omelet. While Toby Determined mentions that Gideon knew about his secret horrifying birthmark that he keeps hidden for obvious reasons. So and of course we do find out that, you know, again, man, we also find out Manly Dan loves little Gideon a lot and puts Blubs and Durland into a headlock, and to the point where Durland actually starts to pass out and sees his grandmother, which implies she's dead. So yeah, they imply that Durland's grandma's gone. She passed away a while ago through a joke, mind you, but it's one of those kinds of things. But of course, it is at this point where, you know, everybody, obviously, Stan and the kids and Soos do wind up infiltrating the Mystery Shack grounds to listen to what Gideon's plans are. And they're ultimately horrified by what Gideon has planned. It's at this point where he reveals that now that he owns the Mystery Shack and is going to close it down, he's revealed that he's going to transform it and its property into a massive theme park in his own image. Which, of course, everybody is visibly disturbed by. But what ultimately, like, specifically the family, everybody else is excited because, you know, it's Gideon. But then Gideon reveals what ultimately winds up getting everybody to finally, you know, snap and finally get in and finally spring to action is Gideon revealing who the new mascot will be, which is that he's dressed up Waddles to look exactly like him. Which, of course, causes Mabel to finally fly off the handle and run up onto the stage with Dipper and Stan in close tow. And they immediately take over the press conference and try to explain to the crowd that Gideon is a lying fraud who stole the Mystery Shack out from under Stan, stole his deed, and doesn't actually legally own the Mystery Shack. Which, of course, Gideon objects to. Very calmly explained to the crowd, he lies, of course, but he very calmly, quote-unquote, explains to the crowd that Stan gave him the deed and that he has it in his pocket. Which, of course, Blubbs and Durland immediately take as fact and be like, yep, that tracks. Gideon owns the shack. I don't see any problem with this. At which point, Gideon summons his hired help to, you know, specifically Tats, who we've seen before, but also a new guy who I don't think has a name. Like, just that he's a hired muscle for Gideon. This is the only time he appears in this episode, and I have no idea who this guy is. Like, he just shows up. But, of course, Gideon has Tats in his doppelganger, in his, I guess his altered version. Like, because they look very similar. But he hires his two hired help muscle, grabs Stan and the kids, And then proceeds to, you know, point out that obviously he doesn't like that Stan is being a sore sport, at which point he gives him a Gideon pain and then proceeds to have to, obviously, because, you know, Stan broke in and tried to, you know, sabotage the press conference, he has them kicked out, telling them not to come back because he doesn't particularly care for them. Yeah, of course, Stan, of course, points out that he's not so tough, Gideon just points out that Stan isn't so tough because he's an old man. Obviously Stan points out that he's not such an old man, but then his hearing aid starts acting up. Again, that isn't something that's come up before, but it is definitely something that Stan would have, because according to Alex, he lives very dumbly, so it makes sense, you know, he would have a hearing aid because he's probably messed up his hearing at some point. But of course, having him been escorted off the property, it's at this point where, you know, obviously the family tries to regroup and point out that they need to figure out a way to get the Mystery Shack back. But it's this point where Wendy appears and tells them that they better, which of course causes Dipper to wonder what's going on. And obviously, Wendy points out the obvious fact that, you know, she works at the Mystery Shack as a summer job, but because the Mystery Shack's shut down, she doesn't have a job anymore. Which unfortunately means that she may have to leave town to join her cousin's logging camp, because her dad points out that she needs a summer job, and that's the only other place she can go. And of course, Dipper is completely distressed about the fact that she's leaving town, pointing out that they need her. At which point, Soos, in a pretty self-aware moment, kind of acknowledges that's especially Dipper because he kind of knows that Dipper has a crush on Wendy, but also can't tell Wendy that Dipper has a crush on her. So he plays it off as the fact that Dipper has a crush on eucalyptus trees and loves them to death. Which, of course, is funny as hell, but also implies that Soos knows. It's implied that Soos knows Dipper has a crush on Wendy. But, of course, this is at this point where, you know, we hear Robbie, who suddenly shows up with a boombox, and insisting that Wendy take him back. And of course, Wendy just gets on her bike and insists that she was never here and just pedals off. Meanwhile, you know, obviously, Dipper and Mabel still are trying to figure out how they're actually supposed to get the shack back. Well, Zeus's Abuelita mentions that she can't feed such a large family and that there's a good chance that they, you know, may need to, that it's not going to cut into her profits a little bit and her food. Dipper and Mabel are trying to figure out how to get their home back, but while Soos, of course, points out that the obvious that Stan is on it, he'll eventually think of something. Stan, of course, unfortunately, does hear this entire conversation from the kitchen, and he's calling Dipper and Mabel's parents. He points out, kind of alluding to what they say about what Stan is going to tell their parents about how they don't have a home anymore. And sure enough, Stan does exactly what he does best, claiming that, you know, he lies, of course. Not telling them that they shacked up with his handyman. He points out, he claims that they're in a nice hotel with plenty of food for them to eat, all of which is a lie. And it does tell the parents that if he didn't think he could take care of their kids, he would absolutely send them right home. But after hanging up and wishing them good wishes, he realizes he can't take care of the kids. Like he very visibly is dejected in the kitchen by himself. And it's very, 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 there's a very good chance that he's going to have to, you know, send everybody home. But, of course, meanwhile, Gideon, having since taken over the Mystery Shack, is, of course, first and foremost, he throws out a picture of Dipper, Mabel, and Stan when they went on their fishing trip, which was a really wholesome moment that Gideon is just discarding, kind of further implying that he's kind of terrible. He doesn't treat anything as sacred. But of course, he also has a whistle that he's revealed to use to control Waddles. Like he forces Waddles to go into stay in a corner, and if Waddles disobeys him, he pulls out a pig whistle, and makes Waddles obey him by fear. So yeah, Waddles is not safe either. But of course, meanwhile, Gideon is, of course, reading through his journal when his father comes in with the clown painting that he recovers from Stan's wall, and proceeds to ask Gideon if he should be celebrating Gideonland instead of looking through his book. At which point, Gideon then proceeds to ask his dad if he knows the true nature of the book. At which point, he then proceeds to explain that it is a journal made by a researcher who was researching the mysteries of Gravity Falls, and that ultimately what happened was he buried it because he knew the secrets, that some of the secrets would be too much for one person to handle. And does reveal that if all of his journals were ultimately brought together and reunited, it would unleash what he puts as a gateway to ultimate power. He then also proceeds to reveal that he has a rough idea of where the first journal is. He reveals that it's somewhere on the Mystery Shack's property, and he has no idea where it is beyond that, other than some diagrams that confirms that it's somewhere on the property. Like, and of course, this causes, you know, obviously, Bud is kind of pointing out that he now realizes why his son was so interested in the Mystery Shack, and of course, calmly explaining that is indeed why. He then proceeds to grab a shovel, and then tells his father that it's time to begin the search while they, you know, work on Gideonland as a front for what they're actually doing. And it's also revealed that McGucket is building something on the premises, implied to be, you know, the statue for the big Gideonland demonstration. But we'll get to that. But of course, it's at this point where Stan then proceeds to come into the living room of Stan's Soos's house, and he then proceeds to reveal the truth, to reveal what he's ultimately thinking, and that he needs to have a serious moment. Dipper, Mabel, and Soos are playing with the slot cars, and because they don't have batteries, they have to slide them around the slots. Don't do that. That just messes up the slot cars. Yeah, I've played with slot cars. That is, my grandparents used to own a set of those. I should mention, that just ruins the slot cars. Please don't do that. But, of course, it's at this point where Stan then proceeds to reveal his plan, which is that he has to send the kids home. He just outright explains that, you know, he doesn't have a job, he doesn't have a house, he can't afford to take care of them anymore. And tells them that their bus will be there tomorrow afternoon. So, he obviously has no choice but to do so. Well, of course, Soos tries to plead with Stan not to do so, but like also trying to use the kids as leverage, pointing out that, you know, they need to look happier because their summer depends on it. But Stan, of course, points out that he doesn't really have much of a choice and that his hands are tied, insisting that Gideon won and there's nothing he can do about it. At which point he walks dejectedly out of the house while Soos races after him, asking him to reconsider. This, of course, causes, you know, Dipper and Mabel to become even more motivated to save their home, realizing that if Stan isn't going to save their home, they have to. And it's, of course, at this point where they point out that they now have the one thing that Gideon doesn't have. And, of course, both get, at the same time, Dipper and Mabel both blurt out A, the journal, and B, the grappling hook. But, and Mabel, of course, ultimately agrees that the journal is probably the smarter of the option of the two. And sure enough, they proceed to go, that next morning, they proceed to go out front to the mystery, in front of the mystery shack. And they quickly realize that if they're going to sneak in, they need to take care of Gideon's muscle. Which, of course, Mabel, of course, declares that she'll take care of it with her grappling hook. But ultimately, she just smacks her brother in the face with it by accident. At which point, Dipper insists that Mabel admit now that the grappling hook is indeed useless. But Mabel is insisting that it'll always be useful. But, of course, now consulting the journal, Dipper then proceeds to think through a couple of different possibilities for things that they can send after Gideon, and at one point, landing on a strange diagram, and that's in the journal. Of course, Dipper admits that he isn't entirely sure what it is, pointing out that it seems to be some sort of diagram for some sort of super weapon of some sort. And of course, Mabel just points out that sounds boring and also not particularly helpful to their situation. So they point out that if they want to take down the guards and take out Gideon, they're going to need some sort of army. At which point, Dipper comes up with one such army, the gnomes, which Mabel is, for obvious reasons, reluctant about. But they ultimately go to try and find Jeff in the woods, end up pointing out that they eventually come into a spot that they are pretty sure is the gnomes' hideout. And they then proceed to wonder what exactly it is that gnomes do out in the woods all by themselves. Case in point, we find out exactly what they do. They finally find Jeff, and he's in a bathtub taking a squirrel bath. Like, that is... Like, that's just the visual you need, is that they take this... he's taking a squirrel bath. Of course, Jeff covers up the idea that there's anything unusual going on, claiming that it's quote-unquote normal for gnomes. But of course, he also is not particularly happy to see Dipper or Mabel, pointing out the obvious that Mabel left him at the altar. And of course, Mabel does apologize for that, but also points out that she's willing to work out a truce, because when she points out that they have another person that they can obviously, they give her a new queen. With Dipper adding that her name is Gideon, which of course, proclaiming that she has beautiful white hair. Which, of course, causes Jeff to immediately perk up, and concluding that they do indeed have a deal, he asks Shmebulak to get him his cologne, and we find out that Shmebulak is the only thing he can say. Unfortunately, well, there's lore reasons for that if you go into the novels and other extended media. There's a lore reason for that, and it's not particularly pleasant, but there's a reason Shmebulak can only say his name. If you want to go into extended media stuff, there is a reason for it. I won't explain it, but if you want to look up the reason, you can go find the books or whatever. So go do that. But of course, with the gnomes now on Dipper and Mabel's side, they then proceed to cut to Stan in Greasy's diner, and he's of course very visibly dejected and asks the waiter for his usual. At which point, it's revealed that Soos now works at Greasy's diner. And much to Stan's surprise, but Soos just explains that, he can't be a full-time handyman anymore because the Mystery Shack shut down, so he's had to take a series of other jobs, including a cook, bus driver, and he starts to list a couple of other things when he realizes that wonders if the kitchen is supposed to have that much fire in it, at which point he immediately goes to go put it out with the fire extinguisher, because it's revealed that the kitchen's on fire. But, Of course, obviously Stan points out that, Soos is a good man-child, but ultimately points out that the obvious that things aren't looking up super great, and that there's very good chance that he's probably not going to be getting the shack back, and he likes that Soos has gotten a bunch of part-time jobs. But, of course, Soos then proceeds to just place a hand reassuringly on Stan's shoulder, telling him that he's there for him. And before it can get into kind of a wholesome moment, it's revealed that Soos's pants are on fire. And when Stan points out to Soos, Soos just pulls him into a hug, telling him that they're having a moment. So, this series loves to get to do wholesome moments while also kind of completely subverting him with a joke, because they can't let the show get too wholesome for too long. That's something that Alex has mentioned commentaries a lot. That every time it goes into some sort of wholesome moment, they end it with a joke to kind of deliberately derail it. Not completely, but just derail it just enough that it stops being wholesome. At least for a little bit. But yeah, because, you know, that's the entire thing with Disney. Just pure schmaltz and sentimental moments and those kind of things. They were like, what if we subvert that by making it funny at the end instead of wholesome? So they do that. But ultimately, it's at this point where, as Gideon is searching for the first journal, he's told by his father that he has a visitor, at which point he sees Dipper and Mabel at the fence that he's erected around the property. And then proceeds to, and of course, it's at this point where they give Gideon an ultimatum. Either hand over the deed to the mystery shack or else. At which point Gideon points out that this is probably the point where he says, or else what? And of course Mabel points out that, yeah, he is supposed to say that. At which point the gnomes proceed to take out both of his hired help and proceed to immediately flood the property and completely surround Gideon. And of course, it's at this point where obviously Dipper and Mabel point out that it's over and tells Gideon to hand over the deed to the shack. Well, of course, Gideon points out the obvious Jeff points out that, you know, to let the marriage ceremony commence. But Gideon has one last trick up his sleeve and admits that he knows when he's beat and he reveals that he has a deed right in his pocket. But then reaches in to pull out his pig whistle and to reveal what the gnome's true weakness is. As it turns out, they have sensitive hearing, which means that any high-pitched noise disorients them. And sure enough, Gideon, taking full advantage of this, realizing that it works on gnomes as well as pigs, and kind of pointing that out, then proceeds to immediately turn the gnomes against Dipper and Mabel. And there's a funny scene where Jeff admits that they will now salute Gideon as their new queen, pointing out that he's the most beautiful woman that he's ever seen. And of course, Gideon insists that he is not a woman, at which point Jeff points out the obvious that, you know, Gideon has very soft skin and clearly moisturizes, so he was a little bit confused. But of course, Gideon then proceeds to sick the gnomes on Dipper and Mabel, and having now completely turned their entire army against them. And of course, pointing out the obvious that, you know, obviously bringing in a gnome army is rather clever, he does proceed to wonder how exactly Dipper and Mabel actually managed to pull this off. At which point, as Dipper struggles to get away from the gnomes, he drops his journal, and it flops open, so Gideon doesn't actually see the cover, but he picks it up. He picks it up and of course starts reading through it. And now realizing this is exactly how Dipper was able to keep up with him, he then realizes that he's kind of feels silly now for considering Dipper a threat. At which point Dipper insists to give the journal back, but Gideon points out the obvious that, you know, he's not particularly threatened by Dipper anymore, because as he goes on to claim, Dipper has no sort of anything that he can do against him. He proceeds to reveal the obvious that, you know, obviously without his journal, he's not much of anything, pointing out that he doesn't have any brains, any muscles, and he doesn't even have any sort of plans, claiming that the journal was the main source of his power. But then pointing out that the two of them will never be able to stand against him anymore, he immediately pulls out his, you know, whistle and just sends them off. But it is of course, you know, at this point where obviously now that the gnomes have, you know, obviously been separated Dipper and Mabel, well, Gideon triumphantly clutches the journal in his hands. First and foremost, Jeff tells them to do their own dirty work next time before running off, and also regathering up his squirrels again. But he runs off with the rest of the gnomes, and it's at this point where Dipper sits rather dejectedly, claiming that the bus will be there in a couple of hours and they should probably go to meet it. Mabel, of course, points out the obvious that, you know, Dipper can't give up, pointing out he's always has a plan, but Dipper then proceeds to reveal that, no, Gideon was right. Dipper doesn't have a plan, never has a plan. Everything he's ever done was cool was because of the journal. And that's obviously, Gideon is very much right about him. Now, obviously, this doesn't track. Like Alex has admitted this on the commentary, and having watched most of this in one sitting, I will openly admit, this does not track if you actually go back and watch the series. Like, if you actually watch, there's a couple of the various times where Dipper didn't have his journal and was able to do something heroic. But Dipper is also an insecure character, so it obviously does make a whole lot of sense that he would absolutely believe if someone told him, you're useless without this thing that serves as a plot, that serves a convenient plot device for us to explain the supernatural stuff in this show. He's obviously gonna believe it. But Of course, realizing they don't have any sort of option to, you know, actually stop Gideon, they decide to just accept their fate and get back on the bus to go home. Which, of course, Stan telling them as they get onto the bus that it's ultimately for their own good, and they have no choice, and they really, and it's unfortunately, they have no choice but to do this. At which point, they part ways as Stan, Candy, Grinda, and Wendy somberly, you know, wave them goodbye. And of course, Dipper and Mabel kind of just watch as their new home is slowly disappears over the horizon, realizing they can't believe this is actually happening as they leave the boundaries of Gravity Falls, Oregon. But Gideon now excited about the fact that, you know, he has officially, you know, beaten the two of them. Then he proceeds to first and foremost, he tells his parents to get out. And before rewriting the journals, claiming that after all this time, he finally has journal number 3. And at which point, Gideon now realizes he's made a grave miscalculation. There are, in fact, 3 journals and not 2. And now realizing he still doesn't have journal number 1, he starts thinking for a minute and realizes he doesn't actually know he doesn't realize where journal number 1 is. And then concludes that Dipper probably still has it. Like, obviously, he thinks that Dipper probably gave him Journal 3 and kept Journal 1 for himself. And now realizing he can't let Dipper or Mabel leave Gravity Falls, he immediately runs outside, and we finally find out what MacGuckin has been working on this entire episode. As it turns out, Gideon asks him if it's ready, and MacGuckin tells him there's only one way to find out, at which point he flips a switch on the back of the statue's head to reveal that it's actually not a robot, a giant statue, but a giant robot. And Gideon proceeds to climb inside of it, put on a motion capture suit, and then proceeds to chase it to... And the Gideon bot, I should mention, is actually a really cool design because it very much reflects Gideon's character. Gideon is a character that, you know, is obviously supposed to be this person who presents this outwardly sweet appearance, but is also secretly this dark poison apple, as Alex explains. So, the fact that his robot is half-painted to represent the duality of Gideon is genius. But Gideon then proceeds to get ready to chase after the kids, while MacGuckin just claims that he's got a good feeling about that kid. It's MacGuckin, so take that with a grain of salt. But ultimately, we do cut to Stan being alone in Soos's house, realizing that he's ultimately hit rock bottom, and he realizes he's got no money, job, a house, and is now sitting infomercials for things that don't really make a whole lot of sense to him. Case in point, there's another Justin Roiland bit in here, because I've talked about Justin Roiland a bit, but. I don't particularly care for him. He kind of threw away his entire career. I will be perfectly honest with that. He just kind of sort of threw away his entire career, and I don't imagine he'll be working anytime soon. But yeah, there's a bit of him doing an owl trowel, promoting a thing called owl trowel. But of course, it is at this point where Stan pulls out the pin that Gideon gave him, and does proceed to wonder how Gideon does it and how he kept being one step ahead of him. When suddenly, his hearing aid starts to go off again. And now trying to figure out where that noise is coming from, he eventually figures it out, and now realizing he knows Gideon's weakness, he gives Abuelita a smooch goodbye. Abuelita is not expecting that. She comes in offering him a snack before he immediately kisses her on the lips and leaves, at which point she declares that she'll go vacuum her face, but ultimately, Stan leaves. But meanwhile, obviously, Dipper and Mabel, they're trying to pass the time, trying to figure out how to best, you know, break time until they eventually arrive back home. But Mabel is trying to cheer Dipper up by trying, under the bus seat treasures, revealing, and of course, Dipper claims he's not in the mood, but she does try to cheer him up, pointing out that there's a miscellaneous fluid stain, a Canadian penny, a wad of gum shit in the shape of Ronald Reagan's face, at which point Dipper adds a giant robot, which of course, Mabel doesn't see, and then realizes goes to see what Dipper's seeing, and sure enough, Gideon is chasing after them in a giant robot. Like, the Gideon bot is just hoofing it after their bus, and with Gideon telling them that he demands them to halt. Of course, Dipper and Mabel immediately become very terrified and immediately run to the front of the bus to tell the bus driver that there's a giant robot and he needs to speed up. And of course, we find out it's Soos, who mentioned he was a part-time bus driver, and of course further clarifies that he's been one for at least 40 minutes. So he declares that he's going to work hard to, you know, that he's been working hard, but they of course tell him to speed up. So he does, and he proceeds to take a detour up to the floating cliffs near Gravity Falls, which of course Gideon proceeds to chase after them, again in the giant robot. And of course, Dipper is completely confused as to why Gideon is chasing after him, pointing out that he's already gotten the journal and he's already gotten their house. What else could he possibly want? So, of course, Gideon continues to put chase after them. Soos eventually gets the bus caught in a dead end because it ultimately winds up on one half of the floating cliffs, and there is in fact no other way to the other side. So there's, but of course, he manages to distract, you know, Gideon long enough for Dipper and Mabel to escape. Gideon tries to rip the roof of the bus off with his robot, but quickly discovers that, you know, Dipper and Mabel are nowhere to be found. And Soos is currently flipping through the emergency bus driver manual to figure out what their present situation is, pointing out that, you know, it might either be a raccoon in the engine or an angry grandparent refusing to leave the bus, and concluding that it's likely the second one. But of course, Gideon does see that Dipper and Mabel have escaped to the train tracks that are connecting the two halves of the floating cliffs. And of course, he immediately jumps down the tracks after them, and eventually corners them in front at the other side of the floating cliffs, and demands to know where journal number one is. Dipper and Mabel, of course, have no idea what he's talking about. With Dipper adding that he has no idea that Gideon took the only journal he has, but Gideon proceeds to tell them that he wants to know more games. At which point, he proceeds to pick the two of them up with his robot. Dipper tries to fight back against the robot, telling him to put his sister down. But Gideon proceeds to ask Dipper if he still thinks he's some sort of hero. At which point, he just has his robot chuck Dipper up onto the floating cliff, and he hits his head on a rock. Mabel pleads with Dipper as Gideon walks away, claiming that once he has the final journal, he'll rule the town and have Mabel as his queen. But Dipper is prepared to save his sister, but then, remembering everything Gideon told him about how he's useless without his journal and he doesn't have any brain or muscles, that he couldn't possibly be a hero, and Dipper seemingly walks off dejected for a while, but ultimately reveals that no, he was just getting a running start, and jumps off the cliff and jumps right in through the eye of Gideon's robot. At which point, he and Gideon have a really fun fight where we only see half of it, but it's clear from how the robot is fighting that Dipper is winning. Like, it's pretty obvious. But ultimately, Dipper man proceeds to tell Gideon, fights with Gideon, telling him to give back his sister inside the cockpit of the giant robot. But we only see the giant robot side of things, which because of how it's framed. They fight Gideon. Dipper fights Gideon, telling him to put down his sister and give back his journal. But Gideon insists that no, that never, and that he's finally won. But ultimately, as they fight, eventually, Dipper eventually gets the upper hand and manages to take the giant robot down by catching Gideon's fist and making him hit himself, which is amazing and really cool, and I love that a lot. Ultimately, Dipper proceeds to make Gideon hit himself, which takes down the giant robot, and it unfortunately falls from the floating cliffs all the way down to the valley below, and with Dipper and Mabel falling after it. And of course, Soos, seeing all of this, is helpless to watch as his two friends seemingly fall to their death. And then there's a giant explosion as the robot hits the ground, and it just sends a massive shockwave that everyone in town sees and feels. And of course, after lingering on the giant robot being destroyed, it's a really cool shot, but of a shot of Gideon's giant robot laying destroyed at the bottom of the floating cliffs, it's revealed that Dipper and Mabel are in fact alive, as Mabel had successfully used her grappling hook to save both of them. And of course, Mabel pointing out that it obviously came in handy. Dipper points out that it was amazing that she was able to use her grappling hook to save them, but Mabel points out that it's not as cool as, you know, Dipper taking out a giant robot by himself. At which point, you know, Dipper finds his journal among the wreckage and picks it up and puts it back in his vest. But it is at this point where everyone in town arrives. The police force, all the citizens, the local news. Like, everyone immediately shows up. Gideon, meanwhile, and I should mention this, this entire ending sequence originally had Gideon in his motion capture suit, but they realized that it didn't really work with what they wanted the, with what they wanted the ending to be, so they had the entire scene redone to, you know, match the idea of, you know, a motion of Gideon instead taking off his motion capture suit before climbing out of the robot. And it works. And like, it shows Gideon, you know, like, obviously, in his, obviously, like, obviously, the entire point is that, you know, Gideon, obviously, would not look as intimidating if he was wearing a ping pong ball onesie, so that's why they changed it. But, yeah, Gideon eventually walks out of the robot, and, of course, Sheriff Blubbs and Deputy Dermot rescue him from the robot and asking him if he's okay. At which point, Gideon, kind of understanding that he still has the support of the town, immediately turns the townsfolk on Dipper and Mabel, revealing that, you know, that they attacked him and blew up his statue with dynamite, and insists that Blubbs and Derland arrest the two of them. Of course, Dipper and Mabel point out the obvious that Gideon's lying, but of course, Blubbs and Derland point out that they trust Gideon and claim that nothing short of a miracle will save them. But they are interrupted when Stan eventually shows up in his car. He winds up running into one of the news trucks, which and scraping up the paint on his car, but which is a fun detail I didn't notice. I noticed for the first time watching. This is what I meant. You can watch this series 8 times and still see new things to see. The side of Stan's car being all scraped up is definitely one of those. But ultimately, Stan gets out of his car and proceeds to tell the townsfolk that he has something to say. Of course, nobody at first is very enthused to listen to him, but of course he does tell everyone to hear him out, at which point he proceeds to point out that they all think Gideon is so special and great and how he can never tell a lie because he's Gideon. But of course, Blubbs and Derlin add the obvious that, you know, obviously Gideon is more trustworthy than Stan is, and is psychic to boot. But it's at this point where Stan rhetorically asks them, how's this for psychic? At which point he kicks open the giant robot to reveal a massive security system and asks everyone to take a good look. And sure enough, everybody sees themselves on the giant security system. Like they see, because it was brought up earlier in the episode, we obviously see that, you know, that's Lazy Susan and Toby Determined, both working on their coffee omelet and going to see the doctor to about their secret birthmark, which, while everyone else just kind of comes to terms with the fact that, you know, obviously it's all of them. Like, it's just all of them on a massive monitor. And of course, Stan then proceeds to reveal the action that, the way he figured it out was that he realized that, you know, all of Gideon's pins and merchandise have cameras hidden inside of them, which is how Gideon was able to spy on everyone. He's been pretending to be psychic while secretly using a security system to spy on everyone. And reveals that he ultimately figured it out because his hearing aid was picking up the feedback surveillance system. At which point he reveals the camera inside his own pin, asking Gideon who the fraud is now. At which point, the town all turn on Gideon. Like, Gideon is, they're obviously everybody's very visibly dejected, very visibly upset with Gideon, pointing out that he lied to them and gave them their trust, after giving them their trust. And of course, Gideon kind of backed into a corner, asks the town what they're going to do with him. At which point, Derlin then turns to Tyler, and Tyler just tearfully tells them to get him. At which point, Gideon realizes his fate is sealed as Blubbs and Derlin read him his rights, and tell him that he's under arrest for conspiracy, fraud, and breaking their hearts. At which point, they pull out the quote-unquote tiny handcuffs, arrest Gideon, and ultimately Gideon despairs as he's ultimately being dragged off, going to be dragged off and taken to prison. But before he does, Stan immediately picks him up, shakes him out to where he both drops all of his belongings, including his journal and the deed. Stan is shown picking up the deed, declaring that it belongs to him. At which point, Gideon is pushed into the back of the squad car and is driven off by Blubbs and Derland. And once he's exposed, he comes full masked off. He declares that the town is a bunch of ignorant sheep, and that they need him, and that he'll be back, and they'll be hearing from his lawyer as he's ultimately dragged off to prison. So, of course, meanwhile, Stan is now declared a hero by Chandra Jimenez and the local news team. And does tell him that what they're going to do to now celebrate their victory over Gideon. And of course, Stan just declares that the mystery check is now back open for business. So at which point, you know, he obviously has a grand reopening celebration where, you know, he obviously overstocks on merch to sell to everyone, even signing some of it. Also, we find out that Gideon has in fact been sent to actual prison, like an adult, actual adult prison at the end of the episode, with his father claiming, and also additionally in a, you know, in a little caption on the front page that, you know, his son could use a timeout. But this is a funny little detail, but it's great. And meanwhile, the rest of the crew fix up the mystery shack. They fix up the roof that Gideon had obviously taken a huge chunk out of, and they ultimately repair the sign, and the S ultimately falls off like it does in the intro. I should mention it does fall off. It did fall off previously when because I didn't mention this. It does fall off previously when Dipper was fighting Sherlock Holmes on the roof. But it's a lot. But here, the way it falls off actually matches how it looks in the intro. That it falls off and goes completely to the root, so it goes completely to the ground, as opposed to how it looked. So after when Sherlock Holmes and Dipper fought, which is it's on the roof but still very much usable. But now, of course, ultimately kind of fixing, pointing it, and leaving it down there because they realize it looks better that way. They ultimately fix up the shack while Dipper and Mabel ultimately move back into the attic. And Stan, of course, asks if everything's, you know, back to normal, everything's as it was when they last left. And sure enough, Mabel points out that everything is great, pointing out that it even has her favorite mold stains, including one that she's named Daryl. But of course, it's at this point where Dipper, revealing that, you know, he and Mabel had been talking, ultimately decides to come clean about everything that's happened. And then proceeds to reveal that the main reason Gideon came after the shack is because of Dipper's journal. And he then proceeds to show it to Stan, revealing that it's full of a bunch of all the odd secrets and mysteries surrounding Gravity Falls, and that it was a high time that Stan knew about it, especially since it was the main reason he lost his home in the first place. And of course, Stan thanks the kids for showing him, but then also starts laughing it up because he points out that now he quote-unquote realizes where they get it from. At which point he proceeds to reveal that he doesn't actually believe. Again, continuing to deny the supernatural, he tells them that, you know, the journal has just been filling their head with, you know, a whole bunch of mysterious spookums and whatsits and all these other things, but also points out that, you know, the obvious, that some of the things in the book would make actually some pretty good attractions for the mystery shack, and asks if he can borrow it before walking off. Of course, also once again, I'm remarking that there's no such thing as a magic book. But of course, Dipper tries to holler back after Stan at telling him that he needs it. But of course, Mabel points out that Dipper doesn't need it, pointing out that, you know, the obvious, that he's done a bunch of amazing things this episode, and that he took down a giant robot by himself without the journal's help. So, and of course, points out that, you know, he's a hero whether he's got the book or not. Of course, Dipper thanks Mabel for her optimism, but also points out the obvious that he does in fact still want it back, regardless. But of course, Mabel points out that, you know, Dipper will eventually get it back from Stan, pointing out that, you know, Stan's an old man, what could he possibly want in the journal? At which point, they're distracted by Soos, who disguises himself as a moving box and gets him into a water gun fight. Meanwhile, later that night, we find out exactly what Stan wants with the journal. As it turns out, this is where the episode ends. With Stan, like he did in the first episode, punching a code into the vending machine and retreating inside to reveal a laboratory multiple stories deep. He walks over to an elevator, punches a code into it to gain access to the third floor, and upon reaching the lowest level, he strolls past several instruments and other things, and it's clear that whatever's down here hasn't been used in a long time. It is very clear that none of the machinery worked. A lot of the machinery is damaged and clearly doesn't work, and there's cobwebs everywhere. And Stan ultimately walks over to a desk and opens the back to reveal that he has the first journal. And also, it's revealed that he actually wound up palming the second journal when he took back the D from Gideon, and declaring that after all these years, he finally has them all. He proceeds to flip all three journals to the diagram, and then reveals exactly what it is that the diagram is supposed to be. He then proceeds to punch a series of codes and numbers into the console next to the desk, and ultimately, in the foreground, a machine springs to life. And Stan, excited that it's now working, he runs inside and turns it on to reveal a massive portal, which of course he just triumphantly stands in front of as the episode ends, and we see a panorama, we see a slideshow of various journal pages. And that's where the episode ends. Like, there's no joke, there's no anything, it's just Stan standing triumphantly in front of the portal as the first season ends. And that, of course, brings up the obvious question, is Stan a good guy or not? Being perfectly honest, as someone who's seen this show a whole bunch of times, yes, but they kind of do paint him in a bit of a gray light. Like, obviously he's a protagonist of the show, so obviously he's not going to be full evil, but it is clear that he's doing something shady in his basement. Like, it's clear that he's doing something, and this episode and series doesn't make it entirely clear what. At least not at first. We won't find out fully what he's planning until season two, but it's clear that whatever Stan's doing, it's clearly something shady. Like, it's clearly something that he's trying to do without anybody knowing. Like, there's a reason he's hiding out in the basement doing it instead of out in the open. Like, there's clearly some sort of mystery here. But overall, you know, there's the obvious that, you know, obviously Stan's a protagonist of the show, so obviously he's not a full bad guy. Like, that is, like, it very much establishes him probably a morally great character than anything. But yeah, that's how the episode ends, with it, the idea of it setting up that Stan has some sort of portal in his basement, and he's trying to bring it back online for some purpose. We don't know what, we don't know why, but it's clearly important. And also, kind of, you know, given the entire idea of, you know, Stan, of given that obviously Gideon mentioned some gateway to ultimate power, it makes sense. He specifically mentions gateway, so it makes sense it would be a portal. But yeah, it's clear, and obviously I should mention, like, as a final thing, going off of the commentaries, because I mentioned them quite a bit, this final shot of the season of Stan standing triumphantly in front of the portal caused Alex a lot of headaches when it came out, because he was like, why did I invent it? Why did I open that, start that portal? Why did I introduce it? This is going to be a whole bunch of problems. And of course, Michael Rianda, who had kind of left for other things. He was the executive producer on this season, but he left for other things. And, you know, obviously, you know, Michael Rianda was like, oh, that sounds like a real problem. Anyway, I'll hope you figure it out. I'll be on vacation for the next however long. Good luck. Yeah, that's how the episode ends. It's a fun episode, but ultimately a really strong ending to the first season. And obviously, as I mentioned, if the show had gotten canceled here, that would have been really mean, because now we wouldn't have had any idea what this portal is. Obviously, it didn't get canceled, because the show did really well, but that's always good. When a show does well, it doesn't get canceled. Although, a show can still do well and get a lot of buzz on the internet and still get canceled, unfortunately, because again, as I mentioned, streaming services, they release everything in one go, and that's not super great for the longevity of a series. Like, I will openly admit that. That happens a lot. But it's overall a fun season. The first season is fun, and now we're getting into not the second season. We've got a little bit more to cover first. But hope you guys are looking forward to what we're covering next, because you guys, some new fans probably don't know what this is. Older fans probably know exactly what I'm covering next. But ultimately, we're going to be doing that. Kind of a mini series in the middle of season one and two, if you will. Like, you'll understand. You'll get exactly what I'm talking about when you see it. But in any case, that is going to do it for today's episodes. And later this week, we'll cover season two. But for right now, thank you guys so much for watching this review. If you enjoyed, be sure to like, comment, and subscribe, especially since we are going to be covering, well, we're halfway through Gravity Falls at this point, so we're going to be covering as much of Gravity Falls for the rest of the month as we can. We're going to be covering season two relatively soon, as well as another thing that I'm trying to keep a surprise, but you guys know what it is. If you've seen the series, if you're an old fan and have seen the series, you know exactly what I'm talking about. If not, it'll be a new surprise for you if you're a new fan. But Yeah, we're going to go, in any case, we're going to be continuing onward with the review for Gravity Falls month, but yeah, go check it out. Be sure to go and check out the Discord, because in addition to watching reviewing Gravity Falls, and also in addition to having a Discord Discord server where we have a Minecraft server in there now, we also are going to be watching doing a watch along of The Great Gatsby this episode, throughout October. Like at the end of October, we're going to be doing that, so be sure to check that out. And also, we're going to be streaming games for the entire month of October as well. So if you have not, so if you're looking forward to any of those. We're halfway through our games as well, so you missed a couple of them at this point. But go check those out. Again, link will be down in the links will be down in the description for my Twitch. You can also watch them here, but following me over on Twitch helps me get one step closer to being full-time, so I would recommend doing that instead. Be sure to go and check out, of course, to check out my Patreon, because this is obviously a very big project. This took a lot of work to make. I would appreciate it if you were to go and do that. Please go check that out. And also, finally, if you want to, if you want to see more content from me, then be sure to check out the playlist linked in the end screen. The top playlist is Courage Month, or over to the entirely of Courage the Cowardly Dog for the month of October. Whereas the bottom episode for playlist that you probably haven't seen yet is Danny Phantom Month, or over to Danny Phantom. Again, for the entire month of October. So if you have not seen either of those yet, those were two of the more popular ones that I did. And actually, also both of the previous, you know, Halloween ones that I did, because I reviewed Megas XLR for my birthday that one time. But yeah, if you haven't seen either of those, go check them out. And of course, be sure to check out my Twitter for updates and other things, especially go check out my pinned for all of the other stuff that we're doing. But yeah, in any case, thank you guys so much for watching. Until next time, I will see you guys in the next video. Peace!